song, because we already know that where we go worship at is just not the temple. The temple has been set aside. But we also know that who are the temple? We are the walking temples, right? Mm-hmm. So this morning we need them to dwell within us, right? So this morning as this song playing, you start to sing, I want you to lay your hands on your chest and make it personal, make it about you and God. Forget about everything, forget about everyone, because you know what? He wants you to worship him in spirit and in truth. Which means now you're taking your eyes off of man and off of people and you see him. Access that he needed. Do you not realize that out of everything that we've seen and done within the last couple of weeks, and I'm not just talking about the stuff that's going on in social media, look at your life. Look at your life. If you know that you're living on an emotional roller coaster, do you not realize that that is Satan having havoc in your life? He is playing with you. And guess who gave him the access? So what happens? We then. Do you not realize that? But did you know that you have no reason to get mad with God? Because did you make yourself? Whenever you thought you woke yourself up this morning, did you know that God could have took the breath out of your body last night?
That's right.
Did you not realize when you're sitting there walking around mad and holding a grudge with God, did you know that he can let you fall dead right where you are? See, a lot of people think that tragedy is what it takes. But do you not know God will let you sit there and drop dead and then be trying to figure out medical, because you know we live in a society where God is trying to prove what happened. There's no gunshot wound. There's no stab wound. There's no seizure. Just drop dead. And when they can't figure out what's wrong, because after that I cut your body up, because you know what? That's what people do to us. Do you not know that when you, whenever you go for an autopsy, your body is cut up? I never knew that until I seen one. After I seen a child come back home. And one of the things, so what? They take your body parts out and run tests on Christian. Do you not realize that's what happened to us in life? When you go through different things, do you not know that's an autopsy being done? Sometimes it's trying to see what you made of. What you made of? You're sitting there telling people what you can do, how strong you are. Do you not know that when trouble comes, that's an autopsy? Do you know that? Because an autopsy is to find out what caused a death. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
What cause of death? Do you not realize when you go through trials and tribulations and transitions, do you not know that those things are not to break you, but a lot of people break from it? Cause of death. When people going out here committing suicide, cause of death. What? Life issues. Life trials. Dealing with home problems, dealing with children, dealing with no job. You know, people got a lot of stuff on them now. People got a lot of stuff on them. But then we say, I believe. I believe what God say. I trust on the word. I lean on the word. I lean on the word and not on my own understanding. Ain't that what we say? We quote that scripture very well. And I know I just misquoted it. But we say it so much until it's like a memorization. Do you know God don't want us to remember? The word say, hide the word in your what? In your heart. And if you hide the word in your heart, what else did it say?
That you might not sin against God.
So guess what? As much as we quote scriptures, why is it when life get us? When life. And I'm not talking about somebody did something to you, but life, because we made poor decisions of our own. See, we so quick to say what somebody else did. But let's go and talk about what you did. What poor decisions did you make that helped you get where you was at?
Right.
You know, I use me. And I ain't ashamed of using me because I can't talk about nobody but me. You get what I'm saying? I was taught, raised in a church, knew better, and I knew what was classified to be sin. And I committed a sin. And in me committing it, I came up with not one bad decision, but two. But even in the bad decision, God still remained to bless me in the decisions that I made. But now guess what tend to come? Now with them bad decisions I made called children.
My.
I remember whenever I had a Christian, mama told me, she said, yeah, baby, he in your arms now. After a while, he gonna be on your lap. But woo, the day will come when he weigh on your heart. You know, I never understood what that meant. But I know now. Mm-hmm. Because Christian is no longer able to fit in my arms for me to rock and hold him.
Yeah.
Christian is no longer able to sit on my lap for me to hold him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he pressing on my heart. Because you know what make you press on my heart? Is whenever you don't make the decisions and the stuff that I taught you. That's what weigh on the heart. Because of the fact, I use myself as the example with you. So that the stuff that I went through, you don't have to go through.
Yeah.
Do you not realize that's the purpose of all the different people that we study in the Bible? Is that we don't do like they did.
Yeah.
We're supposed to do better, which means we're supposed to make some better decisions. Now, God knew that we was going to mess up. But now, in the messing up, he even showed us how to get up. But do all of us ever get up?
No.
Or do some of us stay there long?
Some of us stay there.
Or is some of us like the prodigal son, we stay out there for a while and then we come to our senses?
Look out now. That's right, we stay out there for a while.
Yeah, exactly. But do we think about it? But even after that, guess what, y'all? Now that you done got over, you done got it correctly, guess what happened? There's still a form of discipline to come. Do we like the discipline? Because let me tell you something, without discipline, that discipline is far more worse than any discipline mom and daddy could ever get to you.
Yes, Lord.
Because of the fact, and it's not to break you. Remember, I said it in the beginning. It is not to break you. It is not to destroy you. It is to build you. But now, here come that doctor with the autopsy. Why is this person acting like this? What you mean, Kendra? What's the autopsy? Because they always trying to figure out what's wrong, right? Am I right or wrong?
That's right.
When the autopsy report comes, the purpose of the autopsy report is to what? Find the cause of death. Alright. Now you done messed up. Wait a minute, because you thought I'm gonna bring it in. Okay, go ahead.
You can definitely
have
some stress. You're already dead. And I told you, if you give me a minute, I'm going to bring it on in to you. Did not do God tell us that he would turn us over to what?
A reprobate mind.
He would give us over to the?
Our affections.
The vile affection of our flesh.
All right. Okay. The wages of sin is what?
Death.
All right. So we already know the wages of sin is death, right? So now, why people, you walking around here thinking you alive, but yet you dead. But yet you dead. What you mean, yet I'm dead and I'm yet alive? Yeah, you right, you alive, but he said that he would give you over to it, right? Everybody that's crazy, let me tell you something. Some people were born that way. But some people turned that way because of what? Sin. And what else? Before you go to bed. Do you not know before destruction comes?
It's a warning.
It's a warning. Do you not realize that's what God do with us? He'll send somebody to say, I don't know what it is that you thought about doing, but I need you to rethink it. What is that?
It's a warning.
He'll tell pastor to preach a message. Have you ever been in church and it's sitting like, Pastor, all in your door, all up in your house, and you trying to figure out, why do this man know so much about me? Why do this woman of God say so much about what's going on in my heart? You know why? First of all, you got to identify, wait a minute, it's not them. It's the Spirit of God that done moved upon them. Mm-hmm. He done stirred up the gift that's inside of them so that they can deliver what you need so you can be set free. But guess what happened? Do we get free? We like the prodigal son, we're going to go out there and eat with them hoes. We're going to find another way around.
That's right.
Disobedience, y'all. But they're going to autopsy. Because now you sick. Everybody want to know what's going on.
What's going on?
Now the medical examiner. And y'all know them doctors, they can try to find out everything. You know what I'm talking about? And the reason why I say that is because we just recently went for an appointment, right? And in the midst of us going for the appointment, the doctor said, I need to do further testing. Do you not know that's the purpose of the autopsy, is to do further testing? Because whenever, now we went back and I said that we go around here mad with God. We mad because of some of the decisions that we made. Lord, leading you to go here, you went there. Because you done got hurt, now you don't want to go nowhere. Do you not realize that? Oh, I can stay here. I can serve God here. Do you not know our strength is with each other? Do you not know we help each other grow? Do you not know we help each other overcome? We overcome by what? Exactly. Can one person fight 200 people? Or are we better in numbers? Or do we have strength in numbers?
Yes, no, we have strength in money.
You have strength in numbers. Christian, money will lead you where? My point exactly. Money can't buy you happiness. So you know what? Look at the place that you want to go down below there. Can money buy you happiness?
No, no.
Some of the most depressed people are people with what?
Money, especially rich folks.
I had someone to tell me I have never met someone that don't have a whole lot but yet happy. And I was like, huh? And they was like, I've never met someone that doesn't have a whole lot, but yet it's still, they're still happy. What is it? Let me tell you what it is.
God.
It's God, because see, first of all, I realized that that paycheck that I want, it don't pay all my bills. It don't pay all my bills. But if I put my trust in God, if I put my trust in Him, He's going to supply what I need. But you know what? What tends to happen is what happens whenever He don't move like what I want Him to move.
You get upset.
Now we're frustrated. But you know what? The frustration, you get past that part. Because see, sometimes you got to minister to yourself. And when you find you got to the place that you can't minister to yourself no more, you better pick up that phone and call somebody to minister to you.
That's right.
Because now you're on dangerous grounds.
Yeah.
Oh, no, Pastor, that ain't true. Yes, it is. You want me to tell you why it's dangerous grounds? Because God didn't put you here to be by yourself.
Come on.
Why would He call 12 when He could have did it all by Himself?
My Lord.
That's harsh.
There would be no reason to call the 12. You know why? Because Jesus could have did everything just Himself. But there had to be a part of the fulfillment of what had to come.
Yeah.
Even down to the two. One denied Him and one betrayed Him. Right? But they had a part in what had to happen. Do you not realize everything that happened in your life, there was a reason and a purpose for it?
Right.
It was ordained by God. The hurt that you felt, it was ordained by God. The stress that you dealt with, it was ordained by God. You know what we say real quick? Everything worked together for the good of them that love the Lord. But what is it? Whenever we start going through, we forget about it.
That's right.
We forget about the good. And you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We forget that in order for Satan to have any attachments to our life, that the Lord has to give him access to it.
Come on.
We forget about that. We forget about that. Why? Because we're so caught up in what's going on. I can talk because I go there too. You ain't nobody in this alone. You get what I'm saying? But when we realize that we don't have to be alone because God didn't call you to be alone, we alienate ourselves, but yet we feel people are against us.
Come on now.
How can people be against you that don't even know you? Why? Because you chose not to let them get to know you.
Yeah.
But yet, we know who God is. God is love, y'all. Do you not know whenever you stay to yourself and you allow the things that has happened in your life, what happens to you? You become bitter.
Mm-hmm.
You have hatred. Can God dwell with hatred?
No, He cannot.
He's a God of love, right? Even whenever you don't deserve it, He still continues to bless you. I started out this institute talking about we get angry. we walk around and we feel that we don't need nobody. Ain't that what I said? But I also said that we get angry with God. Ain't that what I said?
That's right.
We get angry with him, but whenever we get angry with him, we act like we don't even realize that he's still working on you.
Yeah.
You still walking around here breathing, walking and going on. But what happens when he take the breath out of your body now just fall down? You ain't had no heart attack. You ain't had no stroke. Because see, I'm going to go somewhere with it. You ain't had no seizure. You wasn't sick. You just left from the doctor. Had a well check done. Blood work was good. Everything was wonderful. But you just fell dead. Do you not know that that's the type of God we can serve that can take you out of here with no traces of what was wrong with you?
That's right.
But because of the society we live in, remember I said that they send you now for an autopsy. So now they done cut you all up. And the first time I ever seen a body in person, not on TV, I seen that that child no longer looked like a human being. Do you know that's what Satan tried to do to us? Is that he tried to work on us until we no longer look like ourselves?
Yeah.
Now death already that came on, but now you done went and destroyed this body. Trying to prove what happened. But it's still inconclusive. That's what kind of God we serve, y'all. Even to whenever we done did wrong and we not right and we hadn't fully came back over and asked God for forgiveness, he still loves us. Because he got enough of love in us that he would make take away the shame from us. Do you not know he'll take the shame from you?
Yeah.
A lot of us walk in shame because we choose to stay in shame. Because a lot of times what you shamed about, God had already moved it.
Yeah.
You walk in shame because of the guilt that you felt.
Come on.
What part did you play? We be guilty about stuff, y'all, and we act like we ain't guilty. And no, we just as guilty as the next person.
My. So what you're saying...
No, you just... Go ahead, baby.
So what you're saying is everything we do is made by choice.
Yeah. Do you not have a chance to have free will, sir, God? Huh?
Yes,
sir.
Yes, ma'am.
He said, I stand at the door and knock. So that means he got the power to keep the door down and walk in. But he choose not to. Say what? He's a gentleman. Yes, he is. Even whenever the Holy Ghost come, do you know that he'll be sitting there talking to you? Because let me tell you something about the Holy Ghost. He'll speak to you before he speaks to somebody else. So now, once he done came in and we just said what? Before anything happened, there comes a
warning.
All right. Warning come before
destruction.
All right, so warning come before destruction. Let's go here. He gonna start talking to you first, right, Apostle?
That's right.
Before he talk to Minister Gary, he gonna talk to the Apostle, right?
That's right.
So if you don't get it right, now he gonna let it come from somebody else, right?
That's right.
Which means 9 times out of 10, it'll even come from somebody that you know.
That's right.
But you know what we as people do? We want people that know us say anything to us.
No, we don't.
All right. So now, what you don't want to do is ignoring it, right?
Ignoring
and rejecting. All right. So now God done that you ignore and reject it. So now he done send the man, woman of God to preach across the pulpit. And you still reject it. Do you not know God know that you were rejected?
Yeah.
He done made you, he already know. But you know what? Like a parent, as we do, and I refer to it as a parent because we call God our father.
That's right.
So, as a parent, you done gave your child the benefit of a doubt. You looking for your child to do better than what you thought they was. But what tend to happen? They tend to go back and do the same thing that you asked them not to do. What they do? Do it. All right, now, if they came across the pulpit, I don't know what pastor they talking about. Pastor always talking about somebody's business. Now, you know good and well you ain't talking to your pastor. Because half the people nowadays don't want to talk to their pastor because they feel that everything you say to pastor going to preach across the pulpit. I don't know too many people that say it.
Yeah.
But now you know deep in your heart, you ain't talking to pastor. You ain't saying nothing to pastor about what you're dealing with and what you're going through. But because the pastor said it in the message. Y'all know what? That's that guilt. That guilt work on us.
Yes, it does.
He think he know everything. He in everybody's house. Every time you turn around, he always talking about something. But you know what? Do you not realize that's the Spirit of God talking to you? Do you not realize that it's softening your heart and trying to get you to get it right? Do you not know that's what happened with the prodigal son? His stomach, you know, he just had those stomach growls. And he out there feeding out. Come on, man, you got to be to your lowest point to want to eat some slop. I say what slop look like. I'm young, but I remember like when they had them homes and no flies flying around that bucket. Now, you got to be real hungry because you got water mixed in this and all types of food and them hogs up there eating it like it's just the best slop. Just eat it, about to fight each other to eat it. So you know he got to have to knock them out the way so he can get just eat them a little bit. Do you know we got to be to our lowest point to go there? But do you not know some of us were trying?
That's right.
I'm not going back over there. Lord, I know you told me to go back over there. I'm not going back over there. I'm not going to deal with them people. Do you not know that's what he said? Lord, I done told my daddy to give me all my stuff, my inheritance before he died. And I know you don't want to be bothered with me. Just quit saying it to yourself, y'all. Quit saying it. Because God always wants you. There is nothing that you have done that he don't want you. Do you not realize that's the more that he do want you?
Yeah.
He wants you because he wants you to be able to stand it for everybody that's around you, that's connected to you, to no longer see who you used to be.
That's right.
Because he realized that once I clean you up. Because you know, we got some leaders out there on the streets that's supposed to be in the pulpit.
Yeah.
We got some leaders out there on the streets that's supposed to own their own businesses.
Come on.
Now you know how much you have to be almost a blame genius to say, oh, don't. What you mean about that, Minister Kendra? You got to cut it up. You got to weigh it. You got to bag it up. You got to distribute it. You got to give it to this person, that person. What's selling this area? What don't sell in that area? Do you know all this stuff? You got a whole CEO. But you got your chemicals. So she said you got to cook it. Ain't that what he's saying? So now you got your person that's got the chemicals. That's got to have the science and the knowledge of it, right?
That's right.
All right, now you got the CEO of the company. Because see, now you got to find out what operates and what works in this area right here, right? Because when you get ready to go set up a legit business, they tell you, survey the land. See what's around you. See what you can set up. Let me tell you something. You cannot go to Rockingham, North Carolina and go open up you a sushi house. You can't sell sushi down there, you know why? Because first of all, you're in an area that does not have a lot of Asians in the area. And I like my fish cooked. I don't know about nobody else. Most people where I'm from, we like our fish fried. Drop it in the grease and pull it back up. Do you not realize what I was going to with that? Because Christian was so excited, I had to bounce back off of that. Because that's scary. Because he was missing what I was saying. But back to what I was saying, we got some smart people, y'all, that's in the streets. We got some preachers that's walking the streets. Y'all think that the messages that them little boys and them little girls sat up on it with grandma, because some of them got parents that's about the age of me, and we got kids that's in their twins. That's scary, but grandma had enough of sense to know that that child was going to need God.
That's right.
So grandma took that child to church. I done met some people that shared their story with me. Grandma and granddaddy raised me in the church. But then when you listen to them, they could quote more scripture to you than I could, and I was still in the church. But what I looked at is, and if I asked somebody, I said, now, if you know the Bible that good, what is it that you choose not to serve God for? Do you know how many people think that they're so lost that God won't save them? And I'm not talking about old people. I'm talking about young people. People that's in their 30s. People that's in their 20s. And you know what? You even got some teens that think that they done messed up so much that God done left them. And not realizing he called it. Because he know once you come in, everybody around you, because most people like that have a lot of friends. Apostle, you can adapt to this. Most people are born leaders that their friends are just followers that stand there and say whatever you say.
Yeah.
Whenever you see them movies that little girls be watching, Mean Girls and all of that, they always got one girl. One girl and the group just small. If she wore her hair this way, everybody would wear their hair that way. Do you not know that's what we do?
Yeah.
We do that in church, y'all. But are we following the correct leadership? We also got some leaders that we need to examine ourselves too. Are we really leading people right? Or are we leading people to hell? Are we even correcting them when they wrong? But we just said in the demonstration that I got, when God starts speaking, will they take it? And do you not realize God gets time of warning? Because now that came from, he done spoke directly to him. He done spoke to somebody that know him. He done spoke to the pastor that preached it to him. Not the prophet that came along. Pertaining to who the prophet is. And let me go here. Pertaining to who the prophet is. And why you say pertaining to who the prophet is? Because not everybody want to hear from every prophet. Do you not know that was in the biblical days? Not everybody want to hear from so-and-so down the street. Oh, I don't want to hear from him. Every time he says something, he always saying something bad. Girl, did you know every time he says something, he always the key holding in that. Y'all know that happened. Or either they say this one. Ain't something strange about him. Do you not know God know that? Or you get mad because the wine odor that exposed you and told you something that the Lord said, and he don't know you, and you too busy calling up thinking, wine, he smell like wine. Don't get blinded to the message, y'all. Don't get blinded. Don't get sidetracked by looking at the messenger. Take the time to listen to the message. Because at the end of the day, when it all started and you go all the way back down, there passed before the anger that sat in. Do you not know that he witnessed and started talking to who?
You.
To you. So let's not get angry. Let's pay attention. Let's pay attention because of the fact if it all started with you, and it was all starting on your decision making and your choice. How can we get angry with God for the choice that you made? At this time of year, we'll turn the service over into the hands of our apostles.
For this opportunity. Thank God for this second Sunday. We are definitely grateful for it. Thank God for my children this morning, my two sons and my daughter that have made a birthday, one made 9, one made 10, and one made 24. So thank God for them. Happy birthday to you all once again. I saw that while we were live, my youngest son's mother decided to watch this morning, so if you're still watching, tell him Daddy said happy birthday. To my oldest son, happy birthday to you again, and to my daughter that is here, happy birthday. To my niece, happy birthday. My wife has a cousin birthday today. Happy birthday. And to everybody that has a birthday today, happy birthday. She turning her face up, but I think she says she had a cousin or somebody birthday today, so happy birthday. You're going to turn your nose up. So don't turn your nose up. We're going to catch everybody that got a birthday. So can't nobody say they didn't hear us say while we were saying it, happy birthday. And as my great-grandmother would say, birthday. So to the old folk that got a birthday today, happy birthday to you. So we thank God again for this second Sunday this month. We thank God for all that he has allowed us to do. I love the analogy that was given, because when we die, God decided to just allow all of the air, the oxygen to be taken out and nothing be left but nitrogen and carbon dioxide. Our bodies would not be able
to survive. Our lungs would not be able to handle it. Our lungs would begin to swell up and our bodies would combust into fire because of the fact that the oxygen has been depleted, and we would swell and we would burst because we could not handle being without oxygen, and our eyes would begin to bulge out of our bodies. Our hearts would not be able to pump like it should because it would be overworking because there's no oxygen coming from the lungs being carried through the blood as the blood is being pumped from the heart to the lungs and from the lungs back to the heart and from the heart back throughout the rest of the body back to the lungs and back up to the heart once again because of the way the channels in which God allowed it to be done. And we all are going through a spiritual autopsy right now. God, while we are yet alive, you know, Christian, at one point, if you look at it from the spiritual significance, can we die from a spiritual autopsy? Yes, we can. Or can we die from a natural autopsy? Naturally, you're already dead. They've already taken and cut a V across your chest to open up your chest to begin to exhume your lungs and your heart and your liver and your spleen and your pancreas and all of your vital organs, your stomach, and your begin to take out your large intestines, small intestines. They begin to take out all of the vital organs, and then they begin to cut a little circle around the top of your cranium to pull back the skin in order to cut the cranium and open up the head and move the skull off to pull the brain out. And after they pull the brain out, they pull the brain stem out, and then maybe even pull the spinal cord out to check you out. So when you're going through a physical autopsy, brother, you don't feel nothing because there's no life in your body. They cut you in the jugular, in the vein, while laying upon a metal board, while your head is laying on a block with a draining tube in you to drain the blood out of your body because it coagulates and turns brown because it spoils, it rottens. And so you're dead already, so you don't feel anything. But spiritually, while you're going through God's spiritual autopsy, while he's checking to see what it is that's causing you the problems, that keeping you going back down the same road, telling the same lies, touching the same things, being bothered with the same folks, running in the same crowd, smoking the same dopes, drinking the same drinks that you're drinking, hanging around the same folks that's causing you to cause the same problem, bringing up from home, laying in the same bed with the same folks that you've been laying up with for years, going around and being with folks you ain't got no business being with, causing destruction here and there. Come on, y'all, talk to me. A spiritual autopsy is automatically being done every day.
Yes,
but even in that, he gives you the opportunity to make the decision that once he makes the final diagnosis of what has caused the infection or disease or begin to cause you to die spiritually, because even when you're naturally alive and you go through the doctor and go through some pre-op and you go through all examination because you're feeling ill, like on last night you sat at the table and said you wasn't feeling well. You said you felt tired. You felt that you were still sleepy. And the moment after you finished eating, you went upstairs and began to regurgitate because your body could not accept what you had ingested, because a doctor somewhere along the way, that was an ingestion of something else that didn't reveal what you had ingested. And because of that, your sorrow will cause you to refuse to begin to regurgitate that experience all over the place.
Yes.
Come on, y'all.
Yes.
So when you look at the lesson that was taught this morning from the Morning Institute, you can look at it and we don't look the same. So when God begins to do a spiritual autopsy on us, we don't look the same. That's why the old folks said when they met the Lord, they looked at their hands and their hands looked new. And it wasn't that their hands had literally changed. They recognized that was in a change in what their hands were doing. So where their hands used to touch and fondle and rub upon things that they knew was not theirs, or they had no business touching and rubbing upon, their hands no longer had a desire to engage in that. Come on, y'all, talk to me. Can I help you understand what Grandma meant when she said when she looked at her hands looked new, and when she looked at her feet did it too. Her feet wouldn't slip to go and get in Jane's house and disrupt Jane's house. Her feet wouldn't quit to get in Bobby's business and tell Bobby he had no business continuing to lay with the woman that he was with, because the woman that he was with was laying with Bobby, Mike, and John. Come on, y'all,
amen,
talk to me.
Amen, come on.
Can I help us today?
Yes.
So yeah, when we look at it and look at a spiritual autopsy, the old folks say, when I got saved, something hit me in the crown of my head and it went down to the sole of my feet. That's what they said, right?
Yes.
Anybody know anything about the old church? You know anything about the old landmark? That's what they said. So since he opened up with a spiritual autopsy, autopsy, and she opened up with a natural autopsy, and she opened up with the mere fact that when she saw what happens to a human body, when they go to examine to see what it was that had taken place that caused the person to die, and even in that she was like, sometimes when an autopsy is done, they come back and they still have not found the exact cause of death. They cannot rule out this, that, and the third. So the man up saying, you died of natural causes. They can't say that it was a drug that you had ingested. They can't say that it was an accident that you had been in. The only thing they can say was that the mere fact that God was waiting for you was your time, because there was nothing that was conclusive to say in the toxology and everything that they did to signify the reason why you died was off some other causes other than the fact that the breath of your body had no longer been able to sustain itself, and God caused you to leave this world. So at the end of the day, what do you want with your mama? You're calling your mama. What you want with your mama? You're going to be fine. Any other time, you're moving around and jumping around. And we talking about spiritual autopsy. See, that's what happened when the Spirit of God began to move. I want y'all to catch it real quick, because we will begin to take place. It cuts you going, it cuts you coming. And you can't keep still. Now, I don't want you to misinterpret it. And I don't want nobody that's watching to misinterpret it, because I'm not saying the child got a devil. But see, one thing about Satan, when the Spirit of God began to cut, when the Spirit of God began to move, the devil can't keep still.
Amen.
Mama, you heard that. The old church, Mom, the old folk used to say, you want to know when the devil owned somebody, the preacher began to preach, or the singer began to sing, and the deacons begin to pray, and they pray, and the Spirit of God come in. The people that can't keep still, that's what they used to say was the reason why they couldn't keep still, because they say it was the devil. Everything ain't the devil, y'all. Can I help us today?
Yes.
Everything ain't Satan. And everything that you see happening to you, Satan ain't did it.
That's right.
Because everything that happened, God allowed it to happen, because yes, he touched on it. Then why would we say continually that everything works for our good? And we're saying it's working for my good. We sing songs of that nature.
Come on.
We sing songs we're coming out. But we can't handle what we're going through.
Amen.
We holler about we going up a yonder, but we can't handle going through the wilderness.
Yes.
We're singing songs as Bishop Paul Martin sung, your tears are just temporary, but we can't stand away.
Come on, Larry.
Y'all talk to me now.
Yes.
We're talking about climbing up the rough side of the mountain, but we don't understand that it's not hard climbing up the rough side until we find on the smooth side that we can't even begin to climb, because there's nothing to hold on to.
Amen.
Because at least on the rough side of the mountain, there's some jagged edges and ledges that you can hold on to be able to pull yourself up. And if you get tired, you got something to hold on to. But when the road is smooth and it doesn't seem like nothing is going on, you slip and slide all over the place. And every time you look like you've been doing some progression, you slide back to the bottom. At least on the rough side, if you slide anywhere, there's a ledge that's going to catch you before you land. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
To the bottom. So she talked about something that was good. We should have caught it, because you're right. You got a whole lot of people that are on the street that we have held on the street, and God gonna hold them, because David said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of his Lord, and do his law. He meditate day and night, and then he like a tree that is planted by the water, in his due season he will bring forth his fruit. But some of us, we are those people that stand in the way of sinners, and all those men and women of God that should be given the word of God, we keep them as the prostitute on the corner. And not only do we keep them as the prostitute on the corner, they on the corner, they're working at the jailhouse, they're working at the crack house, they're working at McDonald's, they're working at Burger King, they're working at the house, they're working at the hospital, and they steal the prostitute because you laid up with them, because instead of being the pressure to get out of the way to allow somebody to become their head, you play with them to live with them. Or should I say, you playing them to play with them?
Yes, yes.
So you still causing them to prostitute themselves. Come on, y'all.
Jesus.
Because you still holding them up from being what God had called them to be, and that you ashamed to recognize that God had called them to be anything, because they in the same place as where we are. Sometimes ministering the word of God, and they see us there, but they know they just lived up with us last night. They just done some things with us last night. They just done some things with us last week. And they feel like that's all they're worried about doing, because that's the way you make them feel. And no matter how much you try to encourage them to stop, you don't stop praying with them. How can you say that, preacher? Because I've been down that road.
Help us.
Come on, y'all. Some of y'all still playing that game.
Yes.
Some of y'all playing that game in your mind while you're still mad with somebody. You ain't laid up with them, but you're still playing it in your mind. Uh-oh.
Oh, Jesus.
And you waiting for the perfect opportunity to blame the husband or the wife that you went to say that's the reason why you did it. You did it because you said he or she not making enough money, so you had to make sure that you made ends meet because you got children to feed. You got to make sure the lights stable. You got to make sure your cable stable. You got to make sure your internet stable. You got to make sure your phone stable. You got to make sure you got gas in your car. You got to make sure your hair done. You got to make sure your hair done. You got to keep up your image. You got to make sure you got the newest outfit. Come on, y'all, talk to me. So you're selling yourself cheap. Might be expensive on your body, but on your emotions and on your mind and on your intellect and on your worth, you ain't worth a plug nickel.
Amen.
Amen.
What does that have to do with the morning teaching? Because when you look at the fact that God is doing a spiritual autopsy on us now, even our nation, and we too blind to see that social media is cutting us up, mutilating us, destroying us, taking out every vital part. And it started off with the strongest scalpel that it could, with the mouth of somebody that was willing to say something that was influential, that would catch the eyes, the ears, and the minds of people. And when it began to happen, everybody started paying attention because they didn't guard their mind, they didn't guard their thoughts, didn't guard their lips, and they allowed themselves to become the portion of which the ground was used to be played in. And once the ground was used to be played in, because the seed had been planted, and instead of them recognize what kind of seed was being planted in their ground, because when the seed began to die, you begin to feel the roots beginning to take its place, beginning to take roots. They begin to grow out, and you begin to feel a difference, because there's a difference in something that's taking root in you that's good, that's adding nutrients and beginning to cause you to become vital. There's something that is taking root in you that's beginning to suck you dry from the inside out.
Uh-huh.
I need your Holy Ghost. I need y'all to catch it. Don't worry, for those of you that saw the video and saw the invite and saw that we were talking about Ezekiel 37 in God's hand, I need you to catch it. I'm using what was taking place in the Institute this morning to bring you up to where we're going so that we can understand where God will take it. Because in order to recognize where God took the Institute, for us to realize that there's an autopsy being done on us right now. The medical examiner had been called in. And several months ago, when this election started taking place, the medical examiner on the social media was called in to begin to do an autopsy on this country. So if you didn't catch it, Christian, since you said for real, let me help you understand something. They started the propaganda as it began to come to the close of the final president reign. And as President Obama terms begin to come to an end 2 years ago, and as it get to the end of his second term in office, and as it come into the final 2 years, and it started 2 years ago, and as it got to the end of the second year, and as it came to the close of this year here, the propaganda started and the medical examiner came out, because they began to exercise what they call their right and their freedom of speech to begin to talk about whatever they wanted to talk about, to begin to open and expose and begin to get the minds of those that was already wondering and already crying and already looking for a reason to say that we needed to do things different and better than where we was, because the present president and his administration were causing us to be backdrafted and backset. So now let's put some things into play and get somebody that's willing to be foolish enough to be our mouthpiece while we make a fool and run it the way we want to run.
Uh-huh.
Did you catch it?
Amen.
See, all the enemy got to do is put a word out.
Mm-hmm.
Cause a delusion. Or should I say an illusion? The illusionists came out with their words. They begin to cast doubt and fear. The enemy does that every time you get up every morning. The enemy does that every Sunday when you get ready to church, go to church. Every time you think about trying to get back in church, the enemy casts, I hear your Holy Ghost, the enemy casts an illusion upon you and it causes you to become afraid, to cause you to become fearful, cause you to become fretful, and you get a place where you become doubtful, and you won't even walk into nobody's place of worship to begin to cause yourself to get back into an alliance with God. You'd rather sit at home, pop on the television, open up your social media network, find somebody that has a worship service going on and call yourself being a part of the house of God, but refuse to go in the house because somebody in a regular service somewhere caused you some pain, and you allow the pain to still be there, and they still controlling you like a marionette puppet without strings.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
So when you look at the autopsy that's going on and the medical examiner that started taking place 2 years ago, and they started doing an autopsy on this country, it started cutting it up from how it started 8 years ago with the beginning of reign of our present president. And the things that they didn't like and the things that were done and the things that he wrote in and the things that he vetoed and how he operated and how he allowed and how he didn't and how he did and how he could have done better and what he should have done and what he could have done. But he operated according to what is demanded according to this country that was put into law long before you or I or him ever came into existence.
That's right. Amen.
And according to what had been amended, according to what had originally had been put into place, he stood on what was there and stood on it on the principles according to what was written in the original Latin that was translated into our English verse.
Uh-huh.
Come on, somebody.
Come on.
What does that have to do with anything? Because he was talking about, going into Ezekiel. Before I get there, do you realize what Ezekiel was talking about here while they were taking him to Babylonian captivity, just as Daniel was, and he was part of those that went in because he was a priest as well as a prophet. And while being taken into captivity, he was one of the ones that made sure that he had to remind Israel that they had to stay with God. Because one God, the king, decided to bow down to one God, the king, that came in to take him into captivity. And then the son got up, and he decided to bow down as well. But the people still decided to give up themselves because they said they trusted in God, but their trust really was in man. Look at our country right now. We claim we trust God.
Come on.
We claim Jesus Christ is our Savior. We claim we are led and filled and governed and guided by the Holy Spirit. But in the process of that that have taken place over these last 2 years and over these last several months, leading up to the presidential election on the 8th of this month. Come on, y'all.
Come on.
That was about how many days ago? Today is the 13th. Somebody calculate that for me. I don't know how many years, but I want y'all to tell me how many days ago that was. If the day is the 13th and the election was on the 8th, that was how many days ago?
5.
So 5 days ago, the number of grace. Uh-oh, check it out, y'all. I want y'all to catch it. The number 8, the number of the perfect number of Christ, the perfect deity of Christ. 888 is his perfect deity. The number 5, the number of graces, the number of God showing us mercy, the fact that God will give us some favor. And 5 days later, we still on the rampant and on the rampage, and we still losing our everlasting mind instead of coming together as a unified body in Christ, as a baptized body of believers that really believe in the God of heaven as being the supreme being of this world and the supreme being of this country. And now one of us decided to cause a reformation, to come together, to cause a revolution in the body of Christ, to now cast this country to come back to God.
Amen.
When you look at what happened from Ezekiel chapter 1 to Ezekiel chapter 37, God began to move that as he began to get him to understand and see why he was by the river Shebar and why he was there praying, and God called him around about the age of 25 and started prophesying about the age of 30, being in the priestly office because he came from a priestly family after coming from out of the family of Levi and doing the things that God said. He held both prophet and as well as the office of priest, signifying the same office that Christ would hold. Come on, somebody.
Come on.
So as we get ready to get into the message talking about God's hand, how are we going to talk about God's hand isn't everything, but yet our mouths is talking like God ain't moving in nothing?
Amen. Come on.
How are we going to talk about God? You know, he said that, and we know that all things work together for good for them that love the Lord, and that are called according to his purpose. Right?
Yes.
How are we going to talk about the spirit and get a sense of our goals that we know not of?
Come on.
Huh? But yet, in the midst of this, we call one the devil, we call one God. And then the one you call God, you call him a devil. And the one you call the devil, you call him the person of God.
Uh-huh.
Satan himself can't operate apart from God giving him, as you heard the woman of God say, permission. Even if he thought he did it on his own and didn't have permission of God, he still don't realize that God still allowed him to do it because God knew that he was going to become a rogue.
Uh-huh.
How many of us, you said, you worry about our children when you instilled in them what you put in them, and your children, what you instilled in your children, and they still tend to not do the thing that you told them to do, just as Satan became a rogue because God spoke him into existence, but God chose to use him as an agent to keep us in position to where it brings us back in life. See, whenever we decide that we want to get out of line with God, God does things to get our attention. So the hands of God are still in the midst of everything. Ezekiel chapter 37. And we're going to deal with one verse. And I've already given you a pre-introduction, and I've already pretty much dealt with the whole text that's there. But see, we get so excited about the fact that we talk about the valley of dry bones. We living in the valley of dry bones. We been in the valley of dry bones. This country been dry for the last 200 and some years. While we've been perpetrating as though there have been life in us, there's been spirit in us. We've been just like the children of Israel as God gave them the vision. We had a full body. We had all the things that constituted us being the body. We had a heart. We had a brain. We had souls. We had blood. We have muscles, we have bodies, we have everything that constituted us to look like a human being, but that was no life in us. Why would you say that, preacher? And I know some preachers going to get upset and mad and say, how you going to say that because of all of the move of God, because of the great moves of Azusa and all of the other things in the Holy Spirit feeling? Yeah, when the Holy Spirit did that, did it cause America to come back to God? Did it cause America to now bow down to the God of heaven? Did it cause America to accept Christ as his personal Savior and be the main primary God and Christianity be the primary, come on y'all, primary religion in this country? Come on, y'all. See, we ain't gonna speak that because we individualize and we keep religion in our certain sections and searching it to ourselves. And as long as it's individualized to certain religious groups or denominations, we're satisfied.
Come on.
Come on, y'all, talk to me.
Come on.
Ezekiel 37:1, it says, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of a valley which was full of bones. God's hand is a familiar text to everybody because we'll get there and we'll talk about the valley of the dry bones. And here God is dealing with bringing Israel back to him. Mm-hmm. They're in captivity. Mm-hmm. Nebuchadnezzar in his rule after conquering the rest of Israel, the northern kingdoms and the southern kingdom, and bringing them under his rule. Ezekiel being one of those priests as Daniel was, and being one of those prophets as Daniel was, and being one of those men that were of wisdom and of knowledge that he brought in. Because see, one thing about the enemy, one thing about those that will find themselves in political power, one thing about those that put themselves in position to overtake and overrun and overthrow, or put themselves in position to now want to be the heads of state and the heads of the government, they have enough sense to recognize and do the search to find those that have knowledge, that have understanding, that have the ability to be able to rationalize what's going on and give them the type of advice that is needed. Guarantee you that even in this presidential coming up, that there will be somebody that he will have as a spiritual advisor, whether he believe in the God of heaven or not. They will have enough sense to govern themselves to make sure that somebody is giving them some direction from heaven.
Yes.
Look in history.
They
will make sure whether they follow it or not. They will make sure that there is somebody whispering in their ears to give them sound advice. Now whether they follow it or not, you will tell by the rain. You will tell by administration. You will tell by the way they govern. You will tell by how their cabinet. You will tell by how all of those that follow them really govern themselves. You will tell by those that are just really pushovers and just mouthpieces, and those that are really there to take a stand and say, this is what we will and this is what we ought to follow.
Amen.
The prophet, when they were there and did what God said do, they made sure the king followed after God when God gave Israel a king. And if Israel didn't follow what God said, they even told the king that if he did not follow the word that God said, that he was just as in jeopardy of judgment and death as Israel were.
Uh-huh.
In this country, I wonder how many of us as leaders, and I understand respect of the office of each of those that sit in the elected offices that are there, but God stands above it, and how many of us are worried about jail?
Come on, come on.
Preacher, you just got yourself in trouble. Well, I guess my mouth been getting me in trouble since I was a child. Because if God is the God that he say he is, then even those that were godly, and we say we believe what this word say. Y'all talk to me. Don't talk, get quiet on me now. And any of y'all that's watching, don't none of y'all get quiet on me now. Because if we really believe this, then tell me, as a body of believers, because the hands of God moved on Ezekiel and brought him spiritually in a place to show him the condition of Israel. Check out when he found himself brought into captivity by Nebuchadnezzar in the land of Babylon. He had a wife. His wife wound up dying. He wanted him to understand how he felt about Israel and the fact that while his wife was there, he had a beautiful wife. She was a woman to be looked upon. She was a woman to be desired. She was one that everybody wanted. Even the king himself wanted Ezekiel's wife because of the beauty that she had, the stature that she carried, the shape that she had, the intelligence that she carried, and she fortified. And she wound up dying because of sickness. And it brought a very, very, very painful day in his heart. So God wanted Ezekiel to understand that while in captivity, his wife wound up taking sick. His wife wound up dying. Everybody wanted his wife. Everybody was saying this. Everybody was trying to get next to what was here. Anybody ever had somebody try to take what was yours?
My Lord.
You had to stand up for it. You had to remind them that no matter what was being said, that all was well. Because I'm pretty sure that was the Lord that was telling them, baby, you come over here with me and I'll make sure you're well taken care of. Ezekiel can't do it no more. Y'all ain't in the land where you came from. He ain't got the money to do it. He ain't got the ability to protect you. Yeah, he might be a part of the king's advisory board, but at the end of the day, the king wants you here to have. Come on, y'all.
Yes.
And if he opened his mouth, we could have him slaughtered like that. Come on, y'all, talk to me.
My Lord.
Maybe we say that we are doctors of divinity and doctors of theology. Let's understand what happened here now. God is showing Ezekiel how he felt concerning Israel. You don't think God been showing the nation of America how concerned he is about us? Look at the hands of God. You know what has been being done? Every death that has been done, every life that has been taken, whether it has been right or wrong, every natural disaster that has happened over the last 30 years, the last 8 years of our present president reigning in office as our chief and commander of the United States of America, everything that God has allowed to happen from the earthquakes that have taken place. Y'all come on, y'all talk to me. God has been getting our attention to draw us back. And every time something has been devastating and multiple lives have been taken, whether black, white, Asian, Hispanic, we come together for a moment. We call on the God of heaven.
My Lord.
We lay down our denominational differences. Lay down our religious barriers. We put aside our racial tensions. Come together as a people. Band together as one nation under God. Then we stand in a place where we're indivisible. Until we feel that minds and hearts are settled. Everybody slowly but surely go at certain ways and divide themselves once again. Lie to themselves and to the world and to the nation that we or a nation that cannot be denied.
My Lord.
Y'all gonna pray with me?
Yes.
Talking about God's hand, because Ezekiel here before, he led that God wanted them to know that he was tired of what they were doing. Because see, we know how to pray God when it's time to come to the house of God. We know how to pray God. And let me make it clear, it ain't that we playing God because we're playing ourselves. What we think we playing God, we think we doing God's service. Yes. We want to get up and prophesy and tell a lie. We want to get up and lay hands. We want to get up and say that we are doing healing. Y'all talk to me now.
Jesus.
I need y'all to catch it because the hands of the Lord have been moving.
Yes.
And then in preparation, we got 70 days before our president-elect take office. We got 1,680 hours before he take office. You got 100,800 minutes before he take office. You got 6,048,000 seconds before he take office. You got all this time that will elapse in between and before he is sworn in and the inaugural speech is given for him to now take office. And while that is taking place, he set up his cabinet. But how many believers have been setting up themselves as the body of believers of Jesus Christ in covenant agreement in the word of God, governed by God's word, nourished by God's spirit, covered by the spirit of God, washed in the blood of the Lamb, and created in God's likeness
and his image really have stood up to make sure the next reign of the next president follow after the God of heaven. Mm-hmm. Are y'all going to pray with me?
Yes.
The Spirit of the Lord took him, carried him in a bag, showed him some bones, showed him the lifelessness of Israel, showed him the lifelessness of the people that he had picked out of all of the nations in the earth. God allowed us to leave from one side of the world to come to the other side. But to come to this side in order that the gospel may be spread, that salvation may be brought, that there are no excuses to say that you didn't know who Christ was. You heard that it was talked about the coming Messiah, and you didn't know if he had came, but now you know. You came over so that you had the freedom to be able to praise and worship him as you would. You didn't have to worry about somebody telling you how, where, when, and what to do, telling you that what you were doing was not right, and even in that you still bow down to the antics of gold that tell you how to worship.
My Lord.
Come on, y'all. It's one thing to suggest, it's one thing to tell, it's one thing to teach, it's another thing to make. What does that have to do with God's hand? Look at the hands of God doing the spiritual autopsy to see the real folk out of that. Because even around the world, when the voices of those that are telling the truth, they quickly silence the voices. Look at history and you'll see the voices of those that God used to expose what was being hidden and how it was being done. What was being done to drive what truth really was out. Their mouths were silenced. Their lives had been taken and they were cut off even what had been written.
Yes.
Are y'all going to pray with me now?
Yes.
Throughout the history of our world, we see these things. But look at Ezekiel, and he's talking about God's hand. He said the hand of the Lord. He didn't say his hand. He didn't say he was in a trance. He said that the Spirit of the Lord, because he had to make sure that being in the office of a priest, which means he had to offer sacrifice. Not only did he have to offer sacrifice, but he had to make sure that the people understood what praise was and how to engage in praise, and what worship was and how to engage in worship with God. They had to make sure that they were mentally, physically ready to engage spiritually. Amen. With God.
Amen.
Come on, y'all. Heard the woman of God said she had to change and shift the music because we had worship music playing. But you got to understand, in order to get in the worship of God, you got to praise God. There's a preparation that has to take place.
Yes.
Before you engage in talking about becoming friends with somebody, there are some things that's got to be initiated in order to gain some contact or gain the favor, gain the interest or the trust of the person that you're trying to play with.
Amen.
Children do it every day. And each time they see each other, there's a routine and a rhythm that they go through before they find themselves really getting into the high place where they are now at the height of their praying and they're having ecstatic fun. That's what children do. God wants us to prepare ourselves. Have our minds really got prepared? We come to the house of the Lord with every and anything on our mind. Doesn't nobody say something to us that bothers before we walk in the sanctuary? Doesn't nobody say nothing while we're in the sanctuary? Doesn't nobody look at us funny while we're in the sanctuary? Don't let somebody get up that we know we had a problem with last week, or that was the person that we had a mission with before. We walked in the house of the Lord. Now they're in God, they're getting ready to sing the songs of praise, and you done turn your nose up, and you done shut God out, and you done ran them forward.
Amen.
Ezekiel, being the priest that he was, stayed in constant prayer with God, because to prepare yourself to open your mouth to sing songs of praise, the first preparation of that is to get your thoughts together. And when your thoughts are together, the next step to that is now beginning to have a conversation or going in prayer with God. Then now you can get your mouth ready to sing a song of praise.
Yes.
Can I help you, praise leaders out there? Can I help you, those of you that have so skillfully and gifted to sing Zion songs? Because God has given you the voice, and he allowed you to have a talent to be able to open your mouth, and you sound like the voice of an angel. Can I tell you, I don't care how well your voice is, you can emotionally stir a crowd, but you can spiritually kill the presence of God.
Amen.
So Ezekiel said, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he carried me in the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of a valley which was full of bones. And every spiritual leader around this country, around these 50 states in this union, around this United States of America, whether you have a Lord's congregation or not, should have been in prayer over 8 years ago.
Amen.
Knowing that a newly elected president, after the first 4 years, and then 4 years later, being elected the same president, we knew that a new election was going to come. But this is what we even do to God. We sit back and we wait. We allow things to continue to permeate. We just let it sit there and fester. We allow the water to sit there until all of the life that's in the water have now left out, and it begins to grow bacteria because it begins to die while it's sitting there. Before 2 or 3 hours have passed, death is already setting in the water. What we have done in this country is that when our past president, before our present president, that sat in the seat for the last 8 years, 8 years prior to that, when the president that left out before, President Obama, came in, we did nothing to bring this country back to God.
That's right.
Y'all pray with me.
Amen.
What does that have to do with the hand of God? God's hand was moving in then, and even during the time of Desert Storm, being a veteran myself, there were things that God was doing to get our attention. Then 9/11 happened, and we still didn't mind coming back to God.
Amen.
Every port around America was on high alert.
Mm-hmm.
We still on high alert.
Amen.
Even being on high alert, we understand this here. That we got to be naturally prepared for all we really spiritually prepared.
Come on.
God got spiritual leaders in natural places that are still not being about his business as they should. They're being held to the position that they got to understand that you got to follow the letter of the law. But in order to follow the letter of the law, God said follow him all first.
Amen.
That's right. They well educated. Look at Ezekiel being an educated man, being a man that understood the law of God, the law of Moses, the Pentateuch. He understood what was said and how it was carried about. And because of the depravity and because of the decrepitness of Israel, God wanted him to see where they really were. Do we really see where we are in our personal lives? You heard the woman of God say, and I got to go back here to incorporate this here, because it goes with the hand of God. It goes with God's hand. God will show you you.
Amen.
Before he shows somebody else you.
Amen.
Before he shows somebody outside your house who you are, he gonna deal with those inside your house. Why? Before he tells some other man to tell you about yourself, he gonna tell your husband to tell you the reason why you listened to other men before. You listen at the man that God gave you, because you don't want to hear nothing that he got to say, and you want to hear nothing that he had to say, and you wanted to listen at somebody else because you already thought he was wrong.
Uh-huh.
Are y'all gonna pray with
uh-huh.
me? Then y'all do the same thing.
That's right.
God been showing us ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
But even in the process of God showing us ourselves and letting Ezekiel know, look, you see what's going on. Look how they're bowing down to the statues that are there. Look how they're giving themselves up. Look how they are giving in to the simple rules that they have now watered down to what God said. God said a man and a woman to be married, and yet in our country we got to the place where we minimized what God said and took the morality and made it immorality, and took immorality and made it morality, and pulled away from God and sanctioned it because we say it's a civil right.
My Lord.
Come on, somebody.
Come on.
Now, I know this is going to hurt somebody's feeling, but I need you to understand. I understand the civil right, but when they come down to what God said, because see, one thing about the enemy, and we're not looking at how decrepit we are, the enemy could not get us to reject God and all the other things that we did. They could not get God to reject us in the mere fact that we decided to establish our own religions and begin to go about just going through the motions as some folk do every Sunday.
Come on,
come on. You go to church because you think it's right. The right thing to do, Mama said it. God told Isaiah, you got to read his predecessors, Isaiah and Jeremiah. And Jeremiah extended lamentations where he began to laugh and he began to cry. He began to cry before God because of Israel. He said in Isaiah, chapter 1, he said, y'all coming together and you calling your convocations, you calling your feasts, you calling your fasting, you calling your festival, but your hand is still there.
My Lord.
Got your holy convocation coming up, your 109th, your 35th, your 5th, your 10th, your 1st, your 2nd, your 200th holy convocation. Has it caused the nation to come together with God? Or has it just caused your fellowship to come together and they paid and made you feel good? Are y'all going to pray with me?
Come on.
He said, the hand of the Lord. Look at God's hand in this country. Look at how God has been moving over the last 8 years.
Look at how God have allowed the things to take place in our country. And well, I named everything, and now I need you to think about it. Those of you that have kept up with those things that are in the political realm, those of you that have kept up with those things that are in the natural realm, those of you that have kept up with those things in the spiritual, has the world come back to God? So look at God's hand saying, look how decrepit they are. Leaders, God has been telling us for quite some time before the iteration of everything that we have, even Carl, leaders that were sitting high, to be exposed.
My Lord.
Not exposed because he wanted to destroy them, exposed because even in the temple, even in the tabernacle, they were still doing things undercover that nobody knew what they were doing, and they didn't have the ability or the access to be able to expose it. And those that tried to expose it, they had those that were on their side then, just as now, they would kill them off.
Uh-oh. Y'all don't want to hear that, do you? Make sure nobody knew who were laying with who and how they were laying with them. They swore that they didn't know that they were defaming the office of God, that after they stepped out of the pulpit of God, stepped off of the riser of God, that when they went in the holy place and went underneath the temple of God, they were offering sacrifices unto devils. Uh-oh. You think that just started happening? The hand of the Lord, he said, Ezekiel, I need you to see this, boy. He said, I showed you all of these visions. I had you laying naked. I had you laying on your right side. I had you laying on your left side. I had you laying and dig a hole in the wall to show how Israel would find themselves going into captivity. I had you taking all your belongings and put it on the outside of the wall, showing what was going to take place. He said, I need you to see now that it's so bad that at this place that they might be alive, but they're still dead.
Amen.
Our country got all the life that it wanted. We want to revitalize it economically and socially. We want to revitalize it financially. The world is spiritual revitalization.
Amen.
Why God keep having me to deal with leaders? Because leaders, we're the ones that's going to make sure that those that are sitting in natural political offices carry out the will of God the way that it should, and they're carrying out righteous judgment. And God can carry many of us out in his spirit. Mm-hmm. We saw the decrepit and the decay of the land. In the valley, they got all our bones. Apostles, bishops, pastors, prophets, missionaries, evangelists, leaders, elders, of every sort, teachers, and they're dry. Very dry. Got a word, but the word is dead. Mm-hmm. Prophesying, but no life is coming. Are y'all going to pray with me? Don't y'all get quiet over now. They showed up at church on Sunday morning, musicians playing the house down, breaking every key on the piano, tearing up every string on the guitars, tearing up everything that they can, and wearing the floor out, and breaking the benches, and whatever you want to call it. God had us trying to get our attention, and he been getting our attention, and nobody paying attention. We just like it was, as Daniel said, the handwriting is on the wall. And old Darius did not want to see the hand of the Lord, but he could not deny that God's hand was writing and telling him what was going to happen, because he decided to take the vessels of God and do things with it that it shouldn't. We're doing that in the house of God now.
My Lord.
Look at the valley that we're in. Look at America in the state that it's in. Look at the church in the state that it's in. God saying to Ezekiel, just as he said to us, Son of man, can these bones live? Leaders, that's what God is saying to us now. He's asking us, can these bones live? Some of y'all got the audacity to answer God back and tell God, yeah, they can live. I've been preaching it. I've been giving them the word of life. You ain't even got sister number J. Bird as Ezekiel had and said, five lords. And wait for God to tell you. I'm going to tell you, go say it. You telling God what you say.
My Lord.
Are y'all going to pray with me now?
Yes.
Look at the text. God's hands are here, Holy Ghost. We're going to extend the invitation. We'll do part two next week. Look at God's hands in America. Leader, God is telling y'all. He asking y'all, as he asked Ezekiel, can these bones live?
He done given many of you some dreams, and you looking at the dreams as everybody else being the one that the dream is for, and you ain't even took the dream and put it back at yourself and look at yourself to make sure you the one. He ain't talking the first, because when he give you a dream, the first person that the dream is for is for you to pay attention to you, look at yourself and get yourself in line, and now you can pose the dream or somebody else.
Amen.
Check it out.
Amen.
You dreamers, and you want to be interpreters of dreams. First interpretation of the dream is to interpret yourself.
Amen.
In the dream as who the dream is about. Then God will allow you to see what the dream is really about.
Mm-hmm.
Saying leaders, can these bones live? Leaders, God is calling us together. My mandate has been the same since I was 3 years old. God calling us together, leaders. We say, God of heaven, Yahweh, Yah, El Shaddai, Adonai, Elohim, El, he's the God, Yahshua, Yahshua, come on y'all,
come on.
You're going to keep calling his name that he was given,
come on.
If that is so, the leader of God calling us out, not Gary, and he been calling us out. Before November 8th, God called us out and we didn't even come out.
Amen.
We individually went to our individual places, but we didn't call ourselves into one place.
Amen.
And those that might have been not able to get that, we didn't even put it to a place where we made sure they got that.
Amen.
But every leader has been for themselves.
Amen.
God is calling us out and asking us, can this country live? You want America to be great? Give it back to God for real.
Amen.
Let Christ really reign. Understand, religious freedom have no problem with it. But even in the days of old, since we want to say that we can't have the new without the old, and the old without the new, then in the old as well as in the new, there was only one that stood above them all, and that was God. That was Christianity. That was Jesus. And if that's what we're preaching, then why is that not what we are living in this country?
Amen.
I can't give you a false sense of hope, but I can tell you there ain't no peace. There ain't going to be no peace in the body until the body comes together as the real body. And stop pretending and perpetrating and faking the funk that we are the body. And we come together just to make sure that we sound good to our people, all the people that are part of our group. Because we still have cliques. We still have schisms. We still have divisions. We still are subdivided within ourselves. We still have racism within the body of Christ.
Yes.
Or should I say, as the word of God tells us, and if you break it down right, there's bigotry within the body. Come on, y'all.
Yeah.
If the Holy Ghost filled your particular denomination, then what makes you think that in this denomination over here, it ain't the Holy Ghost? And then you take the word out of the scripture to try to counteract and condemn them and say that it's not the Holy Ghost. Who made you so judge of what the Holy Ghost is?
Come on.
Paul spent 2.5 years down in Jerusalem with the original apostles to make sure that they all were on the same page. Their words may have not been exactly the same, but their messages was exactly the same. They preached Christ, him crucified, risen, coming down through 42 generations, the Son of David, the Son of God, seated at the right hand of authority, left heaven to come down to earth. The second man, Adam, that took place of the first man, Adam, and brought us back into right relationship with God. God's hand had been moving since before you became the apostle that you are.
Amen.
Before your consecration as bishop.
Amen.
Leaders, hear the word of the Lord. No matter how high you are, you heard the woman of God say, you won't even hear the alcoholic, the prostitute that's smelling like sex, that God just had to walk up to you and don't know nothing about you and tell you everything about you because you wouldn't hear what God was telling you. You wouldn't hear it from your wife, wouldn't hear it from your husband, wouldn't hear it from your mother, wouldn't hear it from your mother-in-law, wouldn't hear it from your son, wouldn't hear it from your daughter, wouldn't hear it from your grandmother, your grandfather, wouldn't hear it from your aunt or your uncle, wouldn't hear it from your cousin. So he had to take somebody that you didn't know and tell them to tell you about yourself. And you had the audacity, the nerve, as you heard the woman of God say, that they smelt like alcohol, or they smelt like sex, or, you know, they just high. They don't know what they're talking about. They're out of their mind. And you know darn well they knew what they were talking about. You just did not want to acknowledge, accept, and apply, and repent and be converted so that God could use you. And you started talking about them so bad that when you walked off, God allowed certain things to happen to you. And he brought back the first thing to mind was the last person he had that came to you that you didn't know nothing about and didn't know nothing about you, for you to receive it, to go back and now bear pardon of where he sent it to you first. I need y'all to catch it. The doors of the church are open. God has. He put him in the valley. Leaders, God been having us in the valley over the last 16 years, because I need us to go back to the last 8 years of the previous president before our present president that's been in the seat for the last 8 years. 16 years ago, God had us at a place where he was putting us in a valley and needed somebody in my left side. I'm glad you're there. So if you're upset and mad about it, I'm sorry. I really don't care. God done had us in the valley, and he showed us how dry this country was. But a man, one of us came together when we saw the opportunity. Those of you that seized the opportunity to be in the light and in the limelight, and that some that God have given the opportunity, that has the eyes of the world and still not using the opportunity that God gave them to bring this country back where it need to be. But we allow the social opportunity to be the means where we stay on top of the means that we want to have to live the lifestyle we want to live. And I'm not knocking you because of that, but God gave you the door to bring the world back to him.
Amen.
I'm sorry. If you don't censor what I say, but I'm good enough to say what you want me to say, because it gives you the lady that you wanted to have, because they keep money in your pocket and you're going to make me feel rich. Mm-hmm. Am I as rich as you that own the company? Uh-oh. But he gave me the opportunity through you to now bring the world back to him, to make God again now the God of this country. Can these bones live? God hand. Look at the hand of God. Leaders, he's calling us out. 16 years ago, he began calling us out. 16 years later, we still cowering and staying in the back and catching the eye of the public to be in the news light or be on social media to say what people want to say that make us seem to look good. I don't have nothing to gain from this other than us coming together and causing this world to now go in reformation and reform and cause a revolution and cause a great revival and bring this country back to God and make our leader follow God as they should.
Amen.
Don't preach about how the prophets made sure that the king followed God when you won't even allow yourself to mandate our present leaders to follow God.
Amen.
I'm sorry. You don't like it, deal with it. If you ain't gonna preach it and really put it into place, stop preaching it. That's all of us.
Amen.
I don't preach for it to be feeling good, because I don't like it either. Reason why I don't like it, because see, I'll be the one that you decide you want to hold ransom. Let's do it. Been in a position where they tried to silence my mouth. Let's do it. The invitation is being offered. God hands. He said it was very dry. He told him to prophesy to the bones. Did y'all catch it? I've already done what was said in there from verse 1 to verse 16. I just gave you the prophetic word today, and now he's calling the north wind, the south wind, the east wind, the west wind. And guess what? 16 years ago, God blew upon America. Guess what? 5 days ago, God blew upon America. And he's still telling us, as he told Ezekiel, he's still asking, can they live? And we, those of us that have been real, still standing up as Ezekiel saying, yeah, they look like it, but they still dry. They ain't got no life. God said, I got it. He stood and said it. So that means if it ain't but one,
God said, open your mouth.
Amen.
You're too afraid of what they're going to say? The doors are open. I'm sorry, I don't have that shouting message that some folk were looking for. Mm-hmm. He had me get that out when I was in Louisiana. I have a job to do. My mandate is different than other preachers. Trust me, I love being able to get my growl and my hoop home. I love it. But at the end of the day, my calling commission since 3 has been to set it in order. And no matter how much I want to hear the music, I want to go it on the key up, I got to follow what the Spirit of the Lord say. And this has been pressing my heart and my spirit. And even now, it's been fought while the message was being preached. Can I tell y'all that principalities and powers, spiritual rulers and wickedness and high places have been fighting it throughout this message? I'm going to put it out there today. It's the first time y'all heard me put it out, so let me call it what it is. Because God had been moving and God had been telling us, he done blew up on it. He done caused the bones to come together. Because see, we like to get to the place, because see, when people hear, you go talk about Ezekiel 37, they want to hear you talk about, you know, the head bone connected to the shoulder bone connected to the neck bone, and the neck bone connected to the arm bone, and the arm bone connected to the breast bone, and the breast bone connected to the hip bone, and all of that other stuff. And they want to hear you say that and get excited about it and make you feel good. Can I tell you, even though all of that have come together, and he gave sinews, in other words, he gave them some flesh. He gave them some eyes. He gave them some nerves. He gave them some blood vessels. He gave them some intestines. He gave them everything that made them look like. And they stood up and they buried them and they still were alive. God breathed them on earth and he still ain't standing up as he should.
Amen.
He said, alas, army. Do you see the army that's in America that belong to God? That's still dead? Apostles? Bishops? Prophets? We still dead. We breathe life where we want to breathe it at. We call it life. But has it caused life to leave out of the walls where we've been at? In the neighborhoods where we have been? Y'all talk to me. He's still saying it was the cross. Had Jesus not went to the cross, can I tell you that? All of this was because of the cross. Everything that happened before that was leading up to the cross. And everything that Christ did in the 33 and a half years that he had led up to the cross. After he died on the cross, shed his blood at the cross, he caused himself to die, laid in a borrowed tomb, got up on the 3rd day, tabernacle for 40 days after dying on the cross, being buried in a borrowed tomb, laid amongst those that were rich as it had been prophesied. He got up with all power in his hands, had a glorified body. He made sure all his instructions was given. But yet while he was in the grave, when he lay there in the grave, the ground shook and broke, and 500 men that had died in the Lord walked the streets of Jerusalem. Come on, y'all, talk to them.
My Lord.
Then when it was time for him to leave, exactly 40 days. 40 days was the final preparation that his body took to now receive the glorification that it needs. Do you realize in your Holy Ghost? Do you realize in the gestation period of a baby, once the egg and the sperm that come together, it takes 40 days for it to actually form a zygote that now begins to look like a baby?
Uh-oh. I hear you, Holy Ghost.
Y'all check it if y'all don't believe it. Takes 40 days for that egg and that sperm to come together and those cells to divide and subdivide, and after they're subdivided, they die. Cells die. Why? It's building, because it's building a network of a nervous system. It's building a network of cells. It's building a brain first before it builds up. Come on, y'all.
Yes.
The head is built before the body. Did y'all know that? The networking of how the information is going to be transferred and carried out is what's built first, and then the rest of it comes through. 40 days to take before it looks like or begin to have the formation of what we call a baby, mm-hmm, or embryo. Come on, ladies.
Yes.
Y'all talk to me. Those of you that are in the medical field, is that not right? God had to take me back to that just now. So 40 days. Come on, y'all. Mm-hmm. Then he went back 10 days later to stay in the car with the Lord. Pentecost was coming. Come on, y'all. Because every 50 days they celebrated the Feast of the Jubilee. They celebrated the Pentecost, the Feast of the Life. Come on, y'all.
Come on.
It's sad to stay in the car, because every 50 days it will say that the Spirit of the Lord came down and dwelled among the people of God. David said he inhabited the praise of his people. Every 50 days the Holy Ghost came down.
The invitation is being sent. God hands. Leaders, God that called us out. 16 years ago, he called us out. 5 days ago, he put us back on the spot. He's still saying, can these bones live? You got 70 days from today. You got 1,680 hours from today. You got 100,800 minutes from today. You got 6,048,000 seconds from today to decide whether or not you want to get to a place that those of us that believe in Jesus Christ, him come in the flesh, crucified by the flesh, risen in a glorified body, tabernacle for 40 days, took a flight back to heaven, seated back at the right hand of God. 10 days later, the Spirit of God now came and inhabited these natural temples, not just the temples that he set aside, because we had to wait for the high priest to go in after offering a sacrifice for himself. I don't need the Pope, I don't need the bishop, I don't need the priest. You ain't gotta offer no sacrifice for me. I can do it for myself. I can get into Holy of Holies whatever I want with right now when I offer my sacrifice by asking God for forgiveness, asking him to wash me in his blood, now give me the right to get into God's presence. So now I don't have to wait for the priest to go behind the veil in order to get into the presence of God, to come back with the glory of God shining upon him for me to see God's glory. I can recognize God. Come on, y'all, talk to me. He's calling us out. So leaders, God and called us out. What are we going to do with it? It's ours to offer. It's yours to accept or reject. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. We'll talk to you on next Sunday. Lord, let us live. God hands. Look what he did. Look how he did it. All of that was leading up to the Reformation that was getting ready to take place in Israel. And even though they was in captivity under Nebuchadnezzar, under Babylonian rule, God promised them that they wouldn't stay that long. But he had to deal with them. He had to bring them into captivity because of their disobedience. Have we brought our disobedience into obedience in order to tell somebody how to bring theirs into obedience? As God had Paul to tell the church at Corinth in his second letter recorded, his third letter written, are we doing that? Look what God is doing. He did that, but he reminded them, even though I'm chastising you, you ain't gonna stay on punishment long. Is that not what a parent does our child? Does his child? Is that not what the woman of God illustrated as well? The punishment not forever. The punishment is for you to recognize what you did. Acknowledge that you did it. Fix what you did wrong. Get it back in line. Walk in obedience. And now all of what you was to get before you got in trouble, you don't get that. But while you was on punishment, the blessings were still being piled up. So you get what was before and what was while and what you're supposed to get out.
Yes.
Is that not what God do? Is that not what the woman of God said this morning in the Institute?
Yes.
It's ours to offer. It's yours to accept or reject. God hands. America, you can put it out there that Garrett said it. I stand on what I know. I heard God been telling me over the last 3 months and over the last 3 weeks and over the last 4 days and how he bothered me all last night. I stand on what he said. I'm going to tell you, God had been dealing with us over the last 16 years, over the last two presidencies that have been there, that have served two terms and a terms of eight years apiece, 16 years total. 5 days ago, we had an election, but leading up to that election 5 days ago, he gave us the opportunity. I've got to remind you one more time. He calling the leaders out. When will we do what God said to now mandate that this country follow Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Understand religious freedom. But those that are going to serve God, he said, choose you this day. Leaders, we can't say this and then pacify it.
Mm-hmm.
I respect everybody and what they want to believe.
Amen.
But at the end of the day, if we say this is the God of heaven and that's who rule this country, then where is it at? Then that's why we in the decrepitancy, decayness, and debauchery that we're in. That's why we in the defilement that we have ourselves in now. God bless you. God keep you. Until we meet again on Wednesday at 7:00. You don't believe anything that I said today came from the Spirit of the Lord. I dare you to do as John said in his first epistle, in his fourth chapter, in the first verse. Beloved, believe not every spirit, But try every spirit, whether it be of God or not. If you believe or think that anything I said is a false prophecy, take it to God. I guarantee you right now, I trust what I know I heard God say 3 months ago, what I heard him say 3 weeks ago, and what I heard him say 4 days ago. And I'll stand on what he said. He's calling us out. His hand has been moving. So brothers and sisters, leaders, I don't care what your color is. I don't care what your creed is. If you're preaching Jesus Christ, him crucified and risen, if you're saying you're apostolic, Pentecostal, holiness, I need you to understand. Then that's what we need to live and preach. Because all of that ties into Jesus being the head.
Amen.
God being the Father. The Holy Spirit being the governor, the sealer, the keeper, and the deliverer. The blood being the washer and the purger.
Yes.
Come on, y'all.
Yes.
If you say you follow the apostles' doctrine, then I need you to understand the full creed.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Come on.
That was before my affirmation. For those of you that think that I only found that out after the affirmation and the consecration, I'm sorry, been knowing it since I was 3. And I'm being bold in the Lord, so I need y'all to understand that before somebody misinterpret what I just said. As we go off the air on Ustream and on Facebook Live, I need you to hear the Spirit of the Lord. As he took Ezekiel in the spirit, lead us, he took each one of us that have really been bona fide in him. And those of us that said God called us and nobody knew that God really didn't call us, but we decided to do it because we thought it was right and it was necessary, but didn't understand God prompted us and moved us. And those that knew that God really didn't call us or thought that God didn't call us, he was calling us, he was moving us, and we did it. He's calling us back unto purity. Ain't that what you said last night, woman of God? Now I'm being funny on this one here. This is me, not the Lord. You thought I wouldn't hear you. She laughs. That's what I wanted her to do. Listen. Hear the Lord. Hear the Spirit. Lead us, he took us. When you can get your eyes off of what each one of us look like in the pigmentation of our skin, and start seeing really who we look like and what we look like in our spirit, we would recognize our brothers and sisters without having them to tell you what their title is, how long they've been in ministry, how long they've been preaching, who is their pastor, who is their overseer.
Yes.
You will recognize the Spirit of God because you would know them as you have known them, and they would know you as you have been known, because the Spirit will bear witness of itself. And you won't have to ask them if they're apostle, if they are bishop, if they are pastor, if they are apostle, if they are leader of whatever sort. You won't recognize them as your brother, recognize them as your sister, and you won't look at the natural flesh only. Our citizenship was in heaven. I'm trying to let go of the Holy Ghost, but he don't want to let go of me. At the end of the day, he called us out. God's hand. Be waiting for part 2 on next Sunday. Let me remind us, 70 days. Think about that number 70. I want you to go back to Genesis, come up to Exodus. I want you to come back to the books of the prophets. There's 16 prophets, but there's 17 books of prophecy. I want you to come up to the Gospels. Then I want you to come up to the letters. And I want you to see them 70 that's in there. You look at that number 70, you're going to see some things that are distinct in there. 70 days before the inauguration of the president-elect, God has given us 70 days to prepare. So all of you that are Islamic and Allah, and y'all waiting for them 70, you know, virgins and all of that other stuff, and y'all richness and what have you, I'm not being funny, but y'all know 70 is significant. So those of you that are still following what is done, and you understand the Jewish law, you understand the Jewish custom, then you're following where I'm coming from. Check the number 70 out. 70 days. Check it out. God bless you. God keep you. Christian, you can take us off the air back there. Evangelist Garrett, you can take us off the air.